Join us on a journey. A journey to learn about the many stories of life on this earth. But not just any story, but the story of life itself. We will take a voyage of discovery, a safari that will reveal the world of wildlife in a new and exciting way. We begin on the island of Bermuda. First discovered in 1609 by Sir George Somers, it is an unspoiled island of natural beauty. Although it has no rivers or streams, it is lush, colorful, and full of character. The locals affectionately call Bermuda God's Island. But beneath the clear turquoise waters is another paradise. At 32 degrees latitude north, Bermuda is the most northerly place on our planet that coral reefs can be found. This awesome watery world is full of variety and color. Bermuda is completely surrounded by reefs, which has made her the shipwreck capital of the world. This ship, the Cristobal Colón, lost in 1936, is now a part of the reef, covered in brain corals, sponges, and sea fans. An inquisitive pudding wife wrasse is attracted by our cameraman's pink fins. This electrically colored fish is equipped with stereoscopic vision. These are eyes that can move individually and in different directions simultaneously, and pectoral fins, which move like oars on a rowing boat. These features are perfect for finding their favorite food. Every creature has its place in the order of things. These butterfly fish have long, thin snouts, which are just the right size to find food in the grooves of these brain corals. Sadly, many of the world's reefs are in danger of extinction. Corals require clean, warm water to survive, and sudden dramatic temperature changes or severe wave action can kill corals quickly. Sand or algae smothering a reef will also kill it. Good coastline management and natural filters like these mangrove trees help protect reefs by holding back sand and other sediments which would otherwise wash down onto the reef. Bermudian waters sadly have been overfished, but a great variety of aquatic life exists, though not in the same quantities of years gone by. A coral reef is an interdependent ecosystem of life forms that cannot survive without each other. A relationship where creatures depend on each other for survival is called symbiosis. If different creatures depend on each other to stay alive now, have they always done so in the past? To answer this question, and others that contradict widely accepted ideas about life on Earth, let us look at the coral reefs of the world more closely. To do this, we leave Bermuda and continue our journey. Coral reef fish have more than a tale to see. They have a tale to tell. It's a story that can be understood by everyone, from the simplest child to the most educated professor. Imagine how incredible it would be to have a collection of books that taught you how to design one of these fish. Their pages would contain the exact details for every cell and tissue type, how big every internal organ, eye and fin should be, what color and markings each fish would have, and how each piece would be positioned in its body. Just a pinhead of this DNA information would fill enough books to reach from the Earth to the Moon and back over 500 times. Miraculously, every living creature contains these instructions for life in its microscopic DNA. When Charles Darwin wrote his Origin of Species, he knew nothing of DNA, and the microscopic codes of life. If he did, his book might never have been published, because the DNA tells a story evolutionists don't want you to know. This debate over the origins of life has raged for 150 years. But now, finally, the debate is over. These fish, like all living things, have an inbuilt flexibility in their DNA blueprints of life. The flexibility allows for adaptations in size, color, and patterning. There are also built-in limits to the amount of change that can take place. In other words, these adaptations will never result in one kind of animal changing into another kind. This means, for example, that you could breed two different species of horse together and produce a hybrid or a third new species. But it would still be a family member of the horse kind. Horses cannot breed with cows or sheep, and even breeding with a donkey only results in a mule that is almost always sterile. Like horses that only breed horses, fish are still only breeding fish. These reproduction facts have been observed for centuries, but now the study of DNA has provided fascinating evidence of a mechanism that helps prevent the DNA's coded information from being corrupted. Although the DNA code has a built-in ability to change, mistakes occur each time cells divide and copy their DNA. These mutations would be very destructive were it not for the code-checking mechanism involving DNA polymerase. When new cells are being constructed, the checking mechanism makes sure that every building plan dispatched to construct each new part is exactly the same as the original code. This is rather like checking photocopies to see if they're the same as the original. DNA polymerase is there to stop mutations and protect against harmful changes. And because additional information cannot be added through mutations or any other means, the adaptations that do occasionally take place in animals do not become more complex in nature as required to support the theory of macroevolution. All of this means that new kinds of animals can never be produced. Only variations or new species of the existing types and kinds of animals. Darwin refused to accept that there were fixed created boundaries between the very different and distinct animal kinds. The classification of species into distinct animal kinds is called taxonomy. These parrotfish play their part in a complex symbiotic relationship where many different forms of life all help to keep each other alive. Corals provide a platform for algae to grow. But if algae grows too much, it smothers the reef and the corals die. The parrotfish provides an invaluable service to the coral reef by consuming the algae. He does this with a strong beak perfectly made just for scraping the corals. Unfortunately, he sometimes bites off pieces of the coral whilst feeding, which he later excretes as sand. The cycle doesn't stop there. An army of sea cucumbers and crustaceans then clean the sand, looking for small particles of food. Corals and sea fans also clean the water, which is vital for all aquatic life to survive. Scientists used to think that parrotfish were destroying the reef. But recent studies now prove that when parrotfish are prevented from feeding on an area of reef, the reef is quickly covered by algae and dies. Parrotfish have some amazing features. Like many fish, their scales are incredibly sensitive to water pressure and movement. This means they can swim in a school and never bump into each other. Another interesting trait of the parrotfish is their ability to change sex, and when they do, their color. This ability gives them a greater chance of survival should large numbers of one sex be destroyed. Incredibly, certain parrotfish also change their color to match their surroundings. This is quite remarkable, given that they're colorblind. The incredible variety of parrotfish worldwide adds color and diversity to coral reefs. But their symbiotic relationship with the corals raises serious questions about the origins of life and calls into doubt the traditional evolutionary model taught today. Coral reefs and coral reef fish cannot survive without each other. And if they can't now, did they ever? The logical conclusion is that they have always lived together. With our modern understanding of DNA, the changes that evolutionists require are wishful thinking, and symbiotic relationships seriously question the idea that different forms of life evolved at different times. So, is there further evidence that seriously undermines this theory? Symbiotic relationships also stretch across environments. For example, most people would never consider that trees and other plants play a vital role in the life of dolphins. Vegetation also keeps you and me alive, because plants produce oxygen, and dolphins, like humans, are air breathers. This means that for as long as there have been dolphins, there must have also been plants. Traditional evolutionary teaching claims that dolphins evolved from some kind of cow or other land-based mammal. But is this really possible? Or is this scientific theory really closer to science fiction? To discover the truth, let us consider some of the changes that will be needed for this evolution to take place. As you can see, the dolphin breathes through a blowhole situated on the top of its head. A blowhole does not connect to the throat, as with mammals who breathe through their nostrils, which enables dolphins to eat while submerged without swallowing water. Any mammal trying to evolve nostrils into blowholes would drown, and the evolution is over. If you ever had water go up your nose while swimming, you can understand the problem. The ability to breathe must work properly immediately, or you die. If an animal's nostrils were still evolving, then water would enter the lungs and the animal would drown. Or, if their blowhole was not fully evolved, it would also drown. The deepest recorded dive of a dolphin is 547 meters, which is about 1,800 feet. The weight of water pressure at this depth is more than 820 pounds per square inch. Imagine the problems facing any land mammal attempting such a dive. They would also not be able to see properly, be unable to breed, sleep, eat, hear, or swim efficiently. All of these functions have to be specially designed for life to survive in the oceans. And most of these features evolving gradually would kill the animal. In light of this, it seems incredible that such ideas are still taught and believed in our educational institutions. Dolphins are powerful swimmers and can easily reach speeds of over 30 miles per hour. This is achieved by a strong, muscular system built upon a lightweight skeleton. They also shed their outer layer of skin cells, which contain small droplets of oil up to 12 times a day. This suggests that their incredibly smooth skin is lubricated, creating a drag-free surface. Any mammal losing its fur whilst trying to evolve into a dolphin, which has no hair, has a serious problem. He would die of the cold before his body could develop the unique body heating system dolphins use called thermoregulation. Dolphin calves are born tail first, because as air breathers, the head has to appear last so the baby does not have to wait to draw its first breath. If it were born head first, they could drown before their entire body has emerged. Any one of these so-called adaptations taking place gradually is enough to kill off any species. And all of them happening together is simply a statistical impossibility in terms of the survivability of the animal. Add to this that any change in design requires intelligence and energy. Humans can design submarines, boats, and scuba equipment because they can study the new environment that they will be entering. Animals do not have this foreknowledge, and the processes of nature alone without intelligence simply do not bring about changes in design. The theory of evolution teaches that everything is continually, gradually changing, evolving perfect capabilities for its living conditions. But this presents Darwin's theory with even more unanswerable questions. The fossil record only shows that the creatures still alive today have not changed in design one bit. So, if animals today are the same as their fossil ancestors, even if they could evolve, what would make them do so? Evolutionists claim that a variety of situations that affect a creature's survival chances cause evolution, like predation, that's being eaten by something else, or changes in the food supply or other changes in the environment that produce a different climate. So does aquatic life show evidence of evolution caused by environmental changes? The surroundings that affect all aquatic forms of life the most is the water itself. Living in a watery environment makes obvious demands upon the way you move. If the evolutionary theory is correct, and living in the sea, for example, was helping to force the progress and direction of an animal's evolution, then the oceans would actually have a very limited variety of creatures, and all very similar in design. In real life, this is not the case. The idea that climate or environment has produced major adaptations is easily exposed when you study movement in the animal kingdom. The Red Sea has over 600 different species of fish, varying greatly in the way they move. So, is it reasonable to suggest that water alone could produce different ways of achieving the same goals? And even if different conditions have existed at some point in the past to produce the huge variety of differences, why are 600 species of fish still able to survive in an identical environment today? Unless this is evidence, they never evolved to begin with. Amongst marine animals, there is a huge diversity in the way things get around. These different types of pufferfish all have an inflexible skeleton. They are propelled by their fins and tails alone, which apart from their mouths, are the only parts that move. Wrasses and parrotfish swim using their pectoral fins like oars on a rowing boat. And then there are the flatfish, who hover along like magic carpets. Turtles, despite being heavy creatures, still move gracefully through the oceans. Their streamlined shells reduce drag, whilst their flippers slice through the water, enabling them to move along effortlessly. The graceful and mysterious manta ray almost appears to be flying underwater. Eels move rather like a snake, winding from side to side. While octopi jet themselves forward by forcing water through a siphon and using their eight legs for additional propulsion. Shrimps, lobsters, and crayfish all use their legs to walk on the ocean floor and across rocks and corals, but also employ an incredibly strong fan-shaped tail to provide sudden thrust if they need to move quickly. Their tails can produce a short burst of speed of up to 90 miles per hour in some species, enabling them to escape from danger. The variety in the way things are designed to move suggests a common ancestor is complete nonsense. This list of examples is by no means exhaustive, and there are many more examples that could be given. So the question evolutionists need to answer is, how did some common ancestor evolve into such a variety of creatures? And why are there no fossils that show these changes have taken place? Evolutionists vainly try to separate science from worldviews or philosophy, but this is both unnecessary and dishonest. With every new scientific discovery, the theory that chemicals could evolve into living organisms is further called into question. And it's not because the facts are difficult to interpret. An evolutionary biology professor at Kansas State University stated, "Even if all the data points to an intelligent designer, such an idea is excluded from science because it is not naturalistic." Throughout history, some of the most accomplished and brilliant scientists recognized that the processes they witnessed in nature did not contradict their faith, and that true science agreed with the Bible. Indeed, many of them were aided in their research by building their scientific foundations upon biblical truths. Amongst others, these have included Sir Isaac Newton, Thomas Edison, Michael Faraday, James Maxwell, and Lord Kelvin. Lord Kelvin, who formulated the first two laws of thermodynamics, said, "Overwhelmingly, strong proofs of intelligent design lie around us. The atheistic idea is so nonsensical that I cannot put it into words." James Maxwell, who discovered electromagnetic field equations, said the following, "No theory of evolution can be formed to account for the similarity of molecules, for evolution necessarily implies continuous change. The exact equality of each molecule to all others of the same kind gives it the essential character of a manufactured article." Sir Isaac Newton, who discovered the laws of motion and gravity, said, "Atheism is so senseless. When I look at the solar system, I see the Earth at the right distance from the Sun to receive the proper amount of heat and light. This did not happen by chance." Words of wisdom from such scholarly men as these could be multiplied again and again. So consider these things carefully and join us again for another part of Life Story. we continue our journey in Africa, the land of safaris, a place where life explodes with variety and beauty. Within this vast continent, people hold to a variety of worldviews. But even a large number of people sincere in a particular belief is no evidence it's true. The truth is the truth whether anybody believes it or not. But when it comes to the evolutionary origins of life itself, is there any evidence that one kind of animal can change into another? Millions today believe this theory to be a fact. But do the facts of life support the theory? Thousands of years of recorded human observation have never witnessed one kind of animal evolving into another. Despite this evidence, millions still believe these assumptions. New species of the same kind of animal from the same type of animal are bred all the time. But is there any real evidence that reptiles have evolved into birds, for example? And doesn't the fact that we still have both reptiles and birds seem to contradict this idea? Birds come in an enormous variety of colors, types, and sizes, each unique. Few are as incredible as the ostrich. The ostrich are the camels of the bird family and are able to survive months without food due to the oil stores in their bodies and more than 5 weeks without water. Most of their water needs are produced internally and the rest they extract from the vegetation they eat. This enables the female to sit on her eggs and guard them for more than 40 days. Her eggs have been specially designed for nesting on the ground, with shells strong enough to take the weight of a full-grown man. But if you fancy stealing her eggs, think again. She could chase you for 30 minutes at 40 miles per hour and still have enough strength to kick you hard enough to kill you. Anyway, the eggs take over 2 hours to boil. So breakfast will be late. Ostriches are among the healthiest creatures on the planet, with the strongest immune system known to man. This means they can live virtually disease-free lives. But like every animal on Earth, they eventually die. Evolution is a theory about escaping death and the survival of the fittest. But the fittest sooner or later die just like the weak. Everything dies because life is more than just that which is physical. Many wonder why the ostrich has wings, even though they cannot fly. But wings can be used for more than just flying. Ostriches use theirs as air brakes and for air conditioning. And although they have no oil in their feathers like other birds have for waterproofing, ostrich feathers are ideal for keeping cool and retaining heat. Perfect if you live in a desert, where hot midday temperatures can drop to minus 10 degrees centigrade at night. Each feather's white patterns are as unique as a human fingerprint. Again, this individuality has no evolutionary value and only highlights the limitless creative ability of a master designer. One thing is certain from both fossilized and living ostriches. They always have and always will only ever produce more ostriches. So, in light of what we can presently see, is the past really that mysterious? Or does the present teach clear, unchanging lessons about the history of life? Is the history of mankind unclear? And what about our destiny? Do we share an ancestor with apes and monkeys, or were we designed and created in the image of God? Certainly, there are those who point out the many similarities that exist between apes and humans, and even other forms of life. But what about the differences? Or are these differences being ignored? because they do not fit the model of evolutionary theory. Evolutionary scientists focus on the many similarities between animals to convince the world that they originated from a common ancestor. The similarities only prove that animals created to live in the same environment need a certain number of common functions and abilities. Unfortunately, evolutionists ignore the many differences which prove conclusively that adaptations produce only new species, never new kinds of animals. Most of the world's fruits are 98% water and vary from each other by a difference of only 2%. But that 2% of difference accounts for size, taste, shape, and color. DNA codes contain billions of bits of information for each life form. So a 2% difference is actually a huge amount. Everyone can see that scales are unlike feathers. And feathers are unlike fur. But how are they different? Well, for starters, they're made from different materials. So a reptile wanting to become a bird has a problem. Where does he get the new materials to change his scales into feathers? And where does the new coded information for these things come from? Even if there was a way for him to acquire these new materials, he would also need a new DNA blueprint to build the new structures. Plus, the existing body parts would all have to be redesigned to make room for the changes. This is why adaptations can only produce new species or variations of existing species. Wildebeest herds migrate to utilize the best food supplies and to reduce their chances of being eaten. Their longer forelegs and sloping backs help them to conserve energy when traveling long distances. Wildebeest calves are able to keep up with the herd less than an hour after being born. When the wildebeest cow is ready to give birth to her calf, she uses an amazing regulatory system to protect her baby from lions and other predators. The wildebeests are the only antelope that can time exactly when they excrete the afterbirth, which attracts big cats and hyenas due to the smell of blood present. If Mrs. Wildebeest is aware of hunters nearby, she will wait until her calf is able to run, and then deposit the afterbirth away from the calf before leaving with her baby in another direction. If wildebeests are the only antelope to have this regulatory system, then it proves they did not evolve from something else, and nothing has evolved from them. Not only this, but the fossil record shows no evidence of wildebeests having been anything else either. Wildebeests are extremely cautious by nature and will run away at the slightest alarm. But how do they know that antelopes, ostriches, and zebra are friendly and lions are dangerous? It is obvious from studying them that they are born with this knowledge. Of course, intelligence and knowledge has to do with information, which is not physical. So where does it come from? For physical bodies to evolve into new life forms requires lots of novel genetic information. But that's not all. How or why would physical matter or chemicals evolve non-physical intelligence and emotions? Surely, it makes more sense to believe a super intelligent designer has left his trademark on everything around us. Like the wildebeest, the giraffe's unique abilities were designed to be fully operational from the very beginning to ensure their survival. Most mammals give birth to their young head first, so their babies do not suffocate whilst passing through the birth canal. The majority of mammals also give birth lying down. This would be dangerous for the giraffe, as she cannot get up on her feet as quickly as other antelopes, and would therefore become easy prey. To compensate for this, giraffes deliver their young standing up. But this method of delivery poses additional problems. Dropping her calf head first from 6 feet high is going to be fatal every time. And evolving a safe system of delivery over millions of years would only ensure the extinction of her species, not its survival. This only allows one conclusion. Her body must have always been designed just the way it is for the birthing process to be safe and successful. Their calves emerge with their long hind legs first, which helps to break the fall. The afterbirth, which is still attached to the cow during labor, also clings to the calf and acts like an elastic rope, further assisting to gently lower the calf to the ground. The calf's neck is carefully folded backwards along the body, with its head resting in the groove of the rear hip during delivery. This protects the head and neck and also exposes the calf's head more quickly, so he can take his first necessary breaths. All this cannot result from trial and error, but only from intelligent design. The giraffe feeds on the leaves from the knobthorn acacia tree using a prehensile tongue. That's a tongue that can be used like a finger, safely removing the leaves from between the sharp thorns. They help pollinate the acacias because pollen rubs off on their necks and is transferred from tree to tree. A giraffe may travel 9 miles a day from one flowering tree to another. It is likely that this type of acacia tree was used to construct the crown of thorns forced upon the head of Jesus prior to his crucifixion. For this reason, it is known locally as the Jesus thorn tree. According to the Bible, thorns are just one result of the curse God placed upon the earth as a result of Adam's first sin. So in a sense, the crown of thorns upon the head of Christ is a symbol that Jesus suffered God's curse in the place of sinful humanity. God's curse upon creation because of man's wrongdoing is the reason why everything dies physically. The Bible says man returns to the dust from which he was created. And every time you clean your house, you're being reminded of this truth. Household dust is made up by more than 85% of human skin. So everything about life today makes sense when we know how it began. Studying the life around us honestly should lead us to the creator of all life. Sadly, men would rather believe the theory tale of evolution than the overwhelming evidence that every eye can see. Fully functional abilities are only proof of design. The lessons of life needed for survival cannot evolve, or the animal would become extinct. Male lions are the only members of the cat family with a long, coarse growth of hair around their head and neck, called a mane. There is much debate about the function of the mane. It may be that God created him with his handsome hairstyle just because it pleased him to do so. In any event, the lionesses seem to find larger, darker manes more attractive. These huge, beautiful cats are formidable hunters. They can achieve speeds of 35 miles per hour, leap 40 feet, and jump 12 feet high. Quite an achievement for an animal with average weights between 275 and 450 pounds. This is equal to the weight of about 80 to 130 tabby cats. Lions are meat eaters, and their victims include zebra, wildebeest, baby giraffe, and antelopes. Small size prey are usually killed by biting the back of the neck, which severs the spinal column, or by breaking the neck with a swipe of its paw. Larger animals are either suffocated when a lion smothers its victim's face in its mouth, or strangled by a bite to the throat. Like all cats, lions can survive on just vegetables. This was proven during World War II when lions in city zoos were only fed vegetables because meat was rationed. Many creatures in the animal kingdom have claws and sharp teeth. but these are used more often for eating fruit and vegetables than meat. A fully grown lion can measure 9 feet from nose to tail and roar at sound levels exceeding 100 decibels. This is louder than a large truck passing you at high speed by the roadside. At such volumes, this terrifying noise can be heard for a distance of up to 5 miles. Lion roars attract pride members and warn other lions that an area is occupied. Like most other mammals, lions have a pair of eyes, 2 ears, a nose, and a mouth. But each lion also has a unique pattern of whiskers on his muzzle. Individuality and similarity at the same time is further evidence of design. All these facts undermine the theory of evolution, and others prove it impossible. In the wild, so-called imperfections are more likely to result in extinction before the animal has had enough time to evolve improvements. Many animals learn some behavior from their parents, while others learn none. But as to how animals instinctively know what they know when they are born, evolutionary scientists only offer unconvincing answers. Why do lion cubs desire mother's milk and not grass, for example? And how does a first-time mother know how to raise her young? Intelligence and thoughts are not physical. So where do they come from? And if humans evolved from apes who are born with their knowledge, then why do we humans now have to be taught almost everything? And how did we lose our instinctive knowledge during the so-called evolutionary process? If we never evolved to begin with, the puzzle disappears. These cubs will one day take their place alongside Africa's most feared hunters. But will their prey ever evolve new defenses to avoid being eaten? The chances are, no. Whether it's an hour, a year, or even millions of years, a dead giraffe like this one has never been capable of passing on any new genetic information to its relatives. So giraffe generations have always been just as they are. These are only a few of the facts evolutionary theory can never overcome. Animals either know what they know when they're born, or their parents already know how to teach them. So the lessons of survival never have enough time to evolve. Even animals within the same family group or kind have unique abilities and differences. This Kalahari wildcat needs speed and cunning to catch the mouse. He winds himself up like a spring before he pounces. His tail gives him balance and acts like a rudder. He jumps forward with paw and claws extended, ready to catch the mouse. But no lunch this time. This black-backed jackal also uses his tail, but mostly to communicate with other jackals. Like other wild canines in Africa, jackals are both hunters and scavengers. Scavenging helps to clean up waste meat, which would otherwise rot and spread disease. Jackals also help reduce the population of disease-carrying rodents. There are great differences between cats and dogs, so although cheetahs appear to have some dog-like features, any misunderstanding is cleared up when you study their lifestyle. Like all forms of life, the cheetah's skills and physical abilities show the evidences of design that imply both foreknowledge and intelligence. It is possible to prove scientifically that something has been designed. One way we can do this is by the study of irreducible complexity. Irreducible complexity simply means that a series of related functioning parts must all work together and at the same time, or the thing doesn't work at all. A bicycle is proof of design because its frame, cogs, wheels and chain must all be in place and fully operational at the same time, or the bicycle will not work. It will be impossible for each part to gradually and independently evolve. The frame must be the exact size for the wheels to fit. The chain must be the right length and strength, and the cogs the correct diameter. This proves that the bicycle is a product of intelligence, energy, and time, not chance. Of course, a bicycle will still work in a limited way with certain non-vital parts missing, but not properly. A design also proves that its inventor had pre-knowledge about how and where his creation would function and built his design accordingly. Cheetahs show the same evidence of design. All creations testify to the existence of the earth before the design. For life in the fast lane, the cheetah's specially designed parts must all work together, proving they could only have been created at the same time. The cheetah has a larger nasal passage than other big cats because they need extra oxygen for greater speed. Their spines are more flexible, and their legs are proportionately longer as well as being slightly further apart. Its claws and foot pads have been made to grip the ground at high speeds, and their body size to weight ratio is lower than the other big cats. Even their tails are specially designed to provide balance and help them turn when moving quickly. The cheetah's larger nasal passage means their teeth are smaller than other big cats, due to the fact that their larger teeth need longer roots to anchor them to the jawbone. If ancient cheetahs were waiting for big teeth to evolve into smaller ones, their original big teeth would have fallen out during feeding time, and cheetahs would now be extinct. The nasal passage, teeth and jawbone all had to be designed at the same time. The evolutionary theory of time plus chance cannot do this. Irreducible mechanisms require an intelligent designer and directed energy. These cats have incredible acceleration. One cheetah was once observed chasing off a rival for almost a mile at 65 miles per hour. Usually they run at about 40 to 45 miles per hour, and only for about 400 or 500 yards before they need a rest. The idea that any animal can wait for vital functions to evolve is absurd. Cheetahs, like all creatures, depend on their abilities to be working properly for survival. Their gestation period, that's the time it takes for them to give birth, is further evidence of created design. Cheetahs give birth more quickly than the other big cats, and their cubs only weigh about 0.5 pound each at birth, compared to an average of 3 pounds for lions and about 1 pound for leopards. This lower weight means that even when pregnant, mum can still hunt efficiently. So the cheetah's life story teaches us not only about their own lives, but about life itself. True science proves that only life produces life, and that non-living things never produce life. But despite the lessons of the past, evolutionary scientists ignore these fundamental facts of science to convince the world that life somehow arose from simple chemicals and then evolved into all the varied and complex life around us. The claims of evolutionary theory are simply impossible. They present biased and unprovable ideas as facts wrapped up in scientific-sounding explanations. For more than 150 years since Charles Darwin's Origin of Species was first published, leading evolutionists have pursued a deceptive agenda to discredit the biblical account of creation. Despite the concrete evidence available shattering Darwin's myths, evolutionists choose to believe in naturalism to numb their consciences to the moral responsibilities logically implied by design. Created means creator. Their primary goal of promoting atheism and humanism is dishonestly hidden behind a smokescreen of pursuing scientific knowledge. The real story is that only life can bring forth life. Only new species and not new kinds of animals are produced. And the relationship between all living things highlights their origins together, not an independent evolution apart from each other. Now, DNA research reveals that the very building blocks of life contain an invisible language, a language of code, whose beginning baffles the scientific world. Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life." Thousands of years ago, the Bible declared, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3, it reads, "Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made by things which do appear." Just as the Bible states, all life is based upon an invisible and sophisticated code. Emotions and thoughts are a part of the invisible life within us, a reflection of the intelligent, invisible God whose words give life. Again, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Jesus once came into the very world he created and was rejected by many of his own people who refused to recognize him. From his own lips, he proclaimed these words, "Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And it is by words, the word of God, that this life is promised to all, who will repent towards God for their sins and put faith in Jesus Christ alone. An intelligent, holy, and loving Creator has provided irrefutable proof to satisfy every honest inquirer who is genuinely seeking to know whether his word can be trusted. The evidence for the truth and reliability of the Bible is staggering. Hundreds of prophecies written centuries before Christ predicted where he would be born, how he would live his life, details of his nature, and even an exact description of his death by crucifixion 400 years before crucifixion was invented. But most importantly, that Jesus, the creator of life, would raise himself from the dead, proving he is God and the only savior of mankind. These prophecies were historically fulfilled to the letter. Not theory or fantasy, but facts. Facts that form the basis of true saving faith, a faith which rescues us from the punishment of hell. So now you know life's story. God made the earth by his power. He established this world by his wisdom. And the heavens that he stretched out by his discretion will be the final home of all who earnestly believe in him. Thank you.
My God is faithful. My God is truthful. My God is boundless in all he is. My God is wisdom. My God is righteous. My God is vision for all who seek. So I will worship you.
That burn like fire. Who is he? Oh, the wonder he inspires. Who is he? Who bore the guilt and shame for those who'd gone astray? His name is Jesus.
To the King, the one true royalty, though king he has.